Hey, I'm William Baxter.
And I'm Paul Bell.
And this is That Review Show, and we're going to be reviewing Star Wars Episode 7, The Force Awakens. The countdown has concluded. All right, well, it's here.
Yeah, it's finally here. The anticipation just built, you know. Finally a little relief.
Yeah. I'd have to say, this is going to be a spoiler. It's, you know, by the time we're filming this, it's been 3 days since we've seen it and everything. Yeah. Everybody in the world's already probably seen this too, so.
Well, I know a few people that haven't, but, you know, I'll pre-warn them.
So, we're just going to go ahead and get right into it. The movie, of course, started without the 20th Century Fox fanfare or anything like that.
Yeah.
It was a little missed.
A little bit.
But it's something that, you know, it's going to be there. It's going to be there, you know, if you want to see it. There's the original films, so, but I have to say, this movie was, as everybody has said, it's remnant of the original film,
yeah.
A New Hope.
It followed the same formula, which, you know, as somebody who's a fan of the original trilogy, you know, I kind of liked that it followed that, and at the same time, it had its nuances, you know, its newer points to it, which was really cool. It wasn't a dull film. No, it wasn't a dull moment.
I'd have to say the same. I felt, you know, at the moment that movie started, you know, when you saw it a long time ago in a galaxy far,
from the opening crawl, just...
When it said Star Wars, I literally teared up.
Yeah.
Because, you know, there's two people in my life that really should have been there. Unfortunately, they were unable to be. But I teared up, and then when I started seeing that opening scroll, you know, when it said Episode 7, The Force Awakens, and, you know, and the scroll was very, you know, it didn't give away everything, it gave you something of what's going on. It said Luke Skywalker has disappeared.
Yeah.
So, enough said right there.
I mean, I like how it set up for the movie.
Mm-hmm.
But it didn't tell you everything.
Yeah.
I mean, especially going through the movie, you saw a lot of, you know, it turned what happened previously turned to more myth, legend. You know, it was such an incredible story. I don't think the people that were alive during the time really believed it happened.
Yeah.
You know, you just hear about these mythical characters, you know, and when they finally start running into the people of the original trilogy, you know, it's like, oh my God, you're that guy?
Yeah.
You
know? Well, it's like, you know, hearing, you know, when I was a kid and everything, I would hear stories about people who've been to Woodstock.
Right.
You know, I knew a few of my friends and everything whose parents were there. And it's like, that's like talking to somebody who says, hey, I was there when Moses was building the Ark. You know, that type of mythical...
Noah built the Ark.
Yeah, Noah. Oh, is it?
Yeah, Noah.
That's right, Noah. See, like, I know.
Yeah.
See?
Moses led the Israelites.
The Israelites. Yeah. See, it's been a while since I've read the good book. So.
40 years, and they didn't at one time just look at him and go, this guy has no idea where he's going. This is bullcrap. He has no idea. 40 years.
Yeah. Well, I feel really stupid.
Something.
My Bible knowledge has been very limited over the years. Okay. I have completely forgotten everything.
Some things you just can't get out of your head.
They
do that on purpose. They might as well smack you with the Bible.
But anyway... Let's get right into it. It started off with a Star Destroyer, and this time it's covering a planet. So these two Star Destroyers are larger than the Super Star Destroyer.
You know, it was the fact that I think it was the fact that a person behind me made note. He's like, "How do you know it's that big? The camera could just be closer to the Star Destroyer than it is to the planet." And then I heard a guy next to him say, "Dude, there's no camera in space catching this. You know that, right? This is for speculation. You need to understand it's just bigger."
You know, your experiences this year with movies and everything, we need to talk about it on the end of the review.
I guess I picked the most interesting times to go.
Yeah.
You know, I picked the times when the people that are really stoned are there, as well as some of the people that have just been kind of drunk. You know, they're like, I can't go home to my wife smelling like this. I think I'm going to go catch a flick.
But anyway, it starts off on this, they never said the name of the planet or anything.
Yeah, they didn't say
the name of the planet. Or was it Jakku? Was it Jakku? I think it was Jakku still.
It may have been.
Well, anyway, you see Poe Dameron, he's having this meeting with this older man, played by Max von Shelton, who they never gave you any hint of who it was, except that he's seen some action, and he's got a history with Luke Skywalker and the other original characters. So Poe Dameron is giving us the map to find Luke Skywalker.
Yeah.
And he suddenly realizes that BB-8, the little character BB-8, comes up and warns him that, you know, there's the First Order, and they're looking for this map to find Skywalker to kill him. So they get there. BB-8 and Poe Dameron try to run away, and they cripple his ship, and then he finds, he tells BB-8 to run, that he'll come back for him, and then all of a sudden, on this command ship comes down, and then it's Kylo Ren coming out.
Yeah.
You get him right off the bat and everything.
It was part of the, you know, fact that it followed the New Hope formula.
Mm-hmm.
The fact that you saw Darth Vader very early on, mm-hmm. you know, I mean, just seeing Kylo Ren at that time, you know, especially the music.
Yeah.
The music just really...
John Williams' score, it was great to see that, hear that still play a factor in this movie. But I do have to say, though, it was something to see that, you know, Max von Schelten, there was all this speculation of who he's going to be and everything. A lot of people were thinking, oh, he's going to be the old Boba Fett.
Yeah.
And then all of a sudden Kylo Ren looks at him, says, you've gotten old. And then Max von, you know, I can't remember everything else that was said, the dialogue that was thrown between each other and everything, but Kylo Ren cuts him in half with a lightsaber.
Yeah.
And then Poe Dameron's captured and everything. And then I have to say, Poe Dameron was, I think, as little as he was in the film, as a progressive character, which means he'll be in it more and more as the movies go on. But he was a great character.
He was. He was, you know, very, just when the movie started going, you know, mm-hmm. he was the kind of introductory main character, you know, to bring you into the story. And just the charisma of him.
Yeah.
Sly, kind of debonair way he introduced things. You know?
Yeah, I like the way, you know, when he was brought up to Kylo Ren and everything, you know.
Yeah.
He's like, so, who talks first? Me?
Yeah.
What?
And then Kylo Ren starts talking. He's like, I can't understand the muffle. You gotta take the helmet off. I mean,
it's kind of reminiscent of a young Han Solo.
Yeah.
You know,
oh yeah.
Just the kind of cocksure way he deals with everything.
Yeah. You know? And if you read the Marvel comics and everything, Poe Dameron's character dates back. You know, his parents and everything were. He was born shortly after the end of the Civil War.
Yeah.
And his parents served with Han Solo, Princess Leia, and Luke Skywalker. So if you read Shattered Empire and everything, it's mostly about Poe Dameron's parents. So check those out and everything. But I'd say when you pick up, you find that Finn's character was a stormtrooper, as everybody speculated. But, you know, he, for some reason, came out of a trance and everything.
Yeah.
And he finally realizes, you know, what he's doing is wrong, and that this is his first mission, and he's...
Well, you come to find out that they start taking children, you know, close to birth and raising them, kind of programming them in a way.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and he states in the movie that it's his first battle, and he froze, you know.
Mm-hmm.
He just realized he had to get out of there. So, I mean, it's kind of questionable, you know, does the programming just kind of wear off and he realizes he's just not made for that? Or, you know, is it something where, you know, just something inside him just says, yeah, no, this is wrong?
Yeah, I don't know. I said it's something that I'm sure they're going to be pressing on more and everything as the film goes on and everything. But, you know, it was a great introduction to these characters.
Oh, yeah.
I mean, it was like boom, 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 you know.
It was very humanizing.
Yeah.
I mean, you got to see, you know, it's one of the drawbacks to the original trilogy. When you first meet Leia, you get that strong female character. They don't really, other than the destruction of Alderaan, they don't really give you a lot of information about her.
Yeah.
You know, Han Solo, confident, you know, pilot, just, you know, you get that feel for him, nothing else.
Yeah.
Luke Skywalker, you get a little more, but
you get
I think
a little
that
more backstory
was because they wanted you to be more attached to him, because
he
was going to be the staple for the rest of the trilogy. But, from the moment they introduced Finn, you know, you could see something unfolding. You got an idea of who he was as a person, not just, you know, his story.
Exactly.
I mean, you got the same thing for Rey too.
Yeah, and she was like the scavenger who was left on this planet, and she was just left there by, I guess, her parents. No one knows who her parents is and everything. There's always going to be these speculations and everything, but we're going to ignore that right now and just get onto the film. But and I have to say, you know, Daisy Ridley did a really great job.
Oh, yeah.
I mean, all of them. Oscar Isaac and you know, they all did great jobs and everything. And just, you know, the fact that when BB-8 and her came apart and everything, the fact that she was living in a an AT-AT walker and everything was, you know, there was a lot of throwbacks cool. too. Little Easter eggs for the original fans and everything that, you know, they see these little bits and pieces of old Empire wreckage and
scavenging in an old Star Destroyer.
Yeah.
Living in an AT-AT walker.
Yeah.
But
also that the little community that had been, that was living there and everything, you know, people who are basically, you know, they're finding these parts and everything and then giving it to this guy just so they can eat.
Yeah.
You know, which, you know, it brings true to like how some countries are nowadays, you know. You know, it's not by economic, the economics are different. All right, well, the BBA character was, I think, the absolute sign of the modern technology that these films, like Lucasfilm and Disney in general and everything, because Bob Iger is the one that found this out about this technology for this character and everything. And I mean, there's tons of videos about, you know, the technology of BB-8's character and everything, so check it out. But I have to say, though, it was like, as we said, we discussed once before, it's a childlike puppy.
Yeah.
Or it's like, you know, the way his movements and the way he was interacting with Finn and everything, you know, and Rey, you know, and the way it moved its head and everything, you know, driving, you know, doing double takes.
It had more energy than you would see through see from 3PO and R2.
Yeah.
I think they were just really capitalizing on the fact that it had more motion to it.
Yeah. Exactly.
Really cool to see.
And it was almost like Benji. I get that feeling about Benji.
I mean, I still think it was more like a really fat baby.
I mean,
wobbled and, you know, just back and forth. Yeah.
Because the trailer, you know, the trailer they showed a year ago.
Yeah.
I thought maybe it'd be about like that small, but, you know, it was probably like the good size of a bounce ball or something.
I don't know if it'd be about that big, but yeah, it was a pretty good size. Just, you know, it was an interesting thing to see, you know.
But the one thing that was really cool is when the TIE fighters were showing up and that scene of the sunset and everything and the TIE fighters coming.
Yeah.
And then all of a sudden they were being, you know, Rey and Finn, they meet and they're being chased and everything. The whole time Rey's like, why are you holding my hand?
Yeah.
You know, like, you know, the female lead is, you know, this is a heroic one. She doesn't need a man and everything. But yet, you know, John Boyega's character, Finn, and everything, he's like, you know.
You know, there was that scene as they're running, he'd already grabbed her hand, what, 3 or 4 times by then? And it's the one time she grabs his hand and hauls his, you know, hauls his rear somewhere else.
But I have to say, though, when they were being chased and everything, the big scene that came up and then people started clapping was the Millennium Falcon sitting there in a junk pile.
Yeah. Well, the fact that they said, we're going to take this ship over here, what's wrong with that ship over there? That's garbage, you know?
Yeah.
Just, you really, it was that old joke about the Falcon.
Yeah.
Everybody, oh, you know, that's just unimpressive.
Yeah.
But the fact that, you know, said ship, you know, beyond them gets blown up and they decide to steal it. The whole theater erupted
at
that point. I mean, I don't think there was a single person in there that was quiet. Just applause. I heard some guy in the back, hell yeah! You know?
I mean, when you saw the way, and the way that, because in the original trilogy, this Falcon was kind of used almost in a very static.
Yeah.
Because of the technology nowadays. You were able to do more with it and everything. You seen the thing bouncing off the ground and, you know, bumping into things. You never saw that before and everything.
Yeah.
You saw it at top shot and air, you know, just lifting off. And even though Han Solo was a more experienced pilot, I guess that's reason why they decided, because Daisy Ridley's character had never flown, but she could. She knew the knowledge.
Yeah, it was the very interesting fact that you got to see it be able to do more. You saw it maneuver.
Yeah.
Which, you know, as we had talked about in a previous review, you never really get to see it truly maneuver. I mean, you see it in the space battle with the Death Star, and it maneuvers there just fine. But seeing it take off, like you said, it was just straight up and gone.
And the flying around the old wreckage and everything, around Jakku and everything.
That was,
and then you started
done.
Sensing that Daisy Ridley, okay, she's force sensitive because, you know, there's something going on because she's just doing all this stuff and she couldn't really understand. She's like, Finn's asking her, how'd you do that? And the scene where she basically stalls the ship out and it flies because the machine gun is broken. And then it gives him the angle to, you know, shoot at the TIE fighters.
I don't know. I had the feeling she might have been force sensitive when she could understand BB-8.
Yeah.
you see she doesn't have a lot of interaction with droids, but she could understand you know, the droid perfectly. Which, I mean, just from the previous films, I mean, from the original trilogy, even the prequel, pretty much only the Jedis could understand the droids other than the other droids.
Yeah.
So, I mean, it's kind of like Han Solo and Chewbacca, you know. It's one of those relationships that you point out and just notice.
And that brings us to the big shot and everything. I have to say, the big eruption that throughout the whole film and everything that it happened when they were finally had the Falcon in space and everything, and then suddenly this barge or something, this wrecked ship and everything comes up, and it catches them and everything, and next thing you know, Daisy Ridley and John Boyega's characters and BB-8 all hide in this little storage compartment and everything, and then all of a sudden the door opens, Han and Chewie comes walking through, and with guns ready and everything, and people are like, you know, people just went crazy.
It was one of those moments where, you know, that the second they got in frame, the entire theater erupted.
And it was impressive just to see them again and everything, you know, knowing. And then all of a sudden,
even that line, you know, just the fact that it was in some of the trailers, you know, the fact that, you know, Han looks into the camera and says, "Chewie, we're home."
Yeah.
You know, I think it just every Star Wars fan who had been there from the original trilogy, even the prequels, was just like, "Yes," you know.
I like it when
there's a feeling of a mutual being home kind of deal. You know, you felt at home watching them; they felt at home being back where they're supposed to be.
I like the scene though when they find out, you know, that Rey and Finn are there.
Yeah.
And then all of a sudden, you know, they ready, you know, all to, you know, go at it and everything, and they're like, whoa, wait.
Yeah.
And he's like, you know, Chewbacca's like puffing a puff and everything, and Finn's like, "You understand that thing?" "Yes, and that thing understands you."
Yeah.
And the bickering of everybody kind of...
I mean, it was one of those things where all the characters really played well off of each other.
Mm-hmm.
They really did. I mean, before Han and Chewie came onto the Falcon, the back and forth between Finn and BB-8, that was funny. That right there, I don't think I heard one person not laughing at the part where, you know, Finn looks at the droid and says, "Droid, please."
Yeah.
I mean, come on.
When he was trying to fake it, that fact that he was part of the Resistance, even though he was...
And it was something that translated through the whole movie, just how well the characters interacted with each other and played off of each other.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
I mean, I had to say, that was... "Droid, please."
Yeah.
I mean, he's like, did they really go there?
Yeah. There was one black guy in the theater. I could hear him in the back, and he went, "Really? Just really? Come on, man." Everybody's laughing so hard they can't breathe, and he's just in the back, just... Why'd they have to go there?
And I have to say, the Finn character, I thought the Finn character was going to be flat and just, you know, outright boring. But he turned out to be, you know, like, nervous. He just wanted to leave.
Yeah.
He didn't want to fight and everything. He knew what he was going up against. He knew what these people were.
Yeah.
But I have to say, though, it was a testament to, you know, these characters and the writing, you know.
Yeah. Like I said, it was very humanizing. They really, you know, nobody had any like for any stormtroopers.
Yeah.
I mean, look at how much heck they've caught over, you know, over the years.
Yeah.
But I think they really had to humanize Finn for you to enjoy the character.
Exactly.
Otherwise, you'd just see him as a stormtrooper.
You
wouldn't be attached to him in any way. This guy gets hit. It's cool.
Yeah.
You know? Which, they must have been doing some sort of upgrades, because he actually made shots that actually hit what was aimed at. So,
yeah.
I mean, that was interesting to see. He must not have been a true stormtrooper.
During that and everything, you can show a picture of Finn or something.
Yeah. I'll find the nervous picture of him.
Droid, please!
There you go.
Okay, well, so they all get together and everything, and then all of a sudden, you know, these people show up that are looking for Han Solo.
Yeah.
And then all of a sudden, you know, all this, you know, come to find out Han's supposed to be smuggling these type of...
some sort of beast.
Yeah,
I can't remember
beast.
The name of them, but they were cool looking.
Like
blood
slugs or something of that nature.
Something of that nature.
But I can remember, you know, Han and Chewie are like, you know, "That's not true. I don't get everyone's always into trouble and everything."
Yeah.
And the bigger between Han and Chewie, you know, it just shows that two old guys and everything that's been around each other far too long.
It was just that friendship. You could just see it hadn't changed.
Yeah.
You know? And it was an awesome thing to see on the screen again.
Yeah.
It just
and
really
to see
was...
Han, you know, taking Chewie's gun after Chewie's been...
Oh, yeah.
Chewie got hit and everything. And, you know, Han picks the gun up and starts shooting. And it's the second time that you ever saw the cross, Chewie's crossbow ever fired. And all of a sudden, Han's looking at it like, wow.
Yeah. Well, so, it's one of those things. He went from a handheld blaster to, a bowcaster.
Yeah.
And that's kind of like going from, 22, Magnum to shotgun.
Yeah.
Which, I like shotgun.
But it was just, Chewie gets injured, and then they're all trying to get to the Falcon and everything. They're like, and they, it's like he's going to get, him and him and Daisy Ridley and everything. You know, they were meshing well and everything.
Oh, yeah.
It was kind of like, they were like talking about hyperdrives, and, she was telling him, this is what's wrong with it and everything. And he's like, I know. And she's like, taking the ship apart and everything, rewiring and everything.
Yeah.
She's like, look, I took the thing out and rewired it and everything. And he's like, damn, this chick's impressive and everything.
One of the only characters you see Han Solo really warm up to in a very quick manner.
Yeah.
I mean, he was just getting used to Ben Kenobi when he got struck down.
Yeah.
That's kind of saying something.
And then just to see, the being inside hyperdrive.
Yeah.
And they're doing it inside the ship while they were still inside the ship and everything. And just expanding on the possibilities of, going through objects.
Yeah.
With hyperspeed and everything, and just the special effects alone and everything were just wonderful and everything. I mean, you could see this in 3D.
Yeah, it was amazing in 3D. I mean, there's not words to really describe, just especially the fact seeing something continue from a childhood, love of it, to seeing it in 3D was just amazing.
Oh, yeah.
I mean, I tend to be colorblind, so I can't always see all the shades.
Yeah.
But just the fact that you could see a couple scenes where the Millennium Falcon was coming right at you.
Yeah.
Just the lightsabers coming at. Awesome.
Yeah.
Awesome.
I mean, and then that leads us up to this one little planet that they go to. It's where this old 1,000-year-old or a little bit more older than that and everything creature. I cannot remember the character's name at this moment.
Started with an M.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But she had these glasses and everything that she was always able to adjust and everything.
Yeah.
And she was, there to help him try to deliver BB-8 back to the Resistance, back to, because BB-8, of course, had, the map to find Skywalker.
Yeah.
But it almost, one thing is this, the journey to find Skywalker almost made it and exciting and everything that it was.
Yeah.
It was, in earlier reviews, it was just, the search for Luke.
Yeah.
But it almost kind of made you forget about Luke.
Well, I think
his absence wasn't so harsh. It was like these characters were so rich.
Yeah. I think that's exactly what it was.
Yeah.
It was the characters were just bantered so well with each other.
Mm-hmm.
Just the introduction of new characters as well as having the staples of Han Solo and Chewbacca.
Mm-hmm.
Just hearing the old names, you knew Luke wasn't there, but at the same time, it wasn't, you were missing him as much as you were feeling just happy to have what you had.
Yeah.
It's just
the absence of Luke, there was no void.
Yeah.
I thought it was going to be so harsh and present towards this film and everything that was going to ruin it for me, but it didn't.
Oh, no.
They really had these characters
tight-knit. If they would have had Luke in there in the beginning, these characters wouldn't have had room to grow.
No. No, that is so true. That is so true.
So his absence is kind of, fortuitous just for the fact that you'll be able to see these characters, from the beginning of the movie, transform into who they become in the end of the movie.
Yeah.
And then they'll continue to grow from there as it goes on.
Yeah. Yes, that is so true.
Yeah.
But I have to say, though, when the thing was is that what really struck me was while they were still on that planet and everything, the creature and everything she mentioned, she had been around for so long, and she talked about the Sith into the Empire, and now this First Order and everything. And then she looks over at Finn and everything, and looks at his eyes and everything. And says, "Eyes can be so recognizable," and knowing that there's some trait history for Finn when it comes to his family, possibly.
Yeah. Well, I don't know if it was so much that she was drawing on the fact that. Everybody's eyes are the same when it comes to emotion.
And yeah.
She brought up his want to run.
Yeah.
The fact that he just wanted to, take off. He didn't want to fight, he just wanted to run.
And I have to say, though, when she mentioned, when she started looking over, she says, "I'm not a Jedi, but I do know the Force pretty well," and she looks at Daisy Ridley, And then, you know, that starts proving that Daisy Ridley is force sensitive.
Oh, yeah.
And, you know, when she goes off into this room and everything, she starts hearing a child cry.
Yeah.
And everything. And then she starts flashing back. And then it's the light. And this was used in the Rebels show.
Yeah.
The lightsaber talking to her. To come.
Yeah, more
because
or less.
It sensed force sensitive person.
Yeah.
Which also proves how strong the bond between a Jedi and the weapon of choice, the lightsaber, is. I liked how J.J. Abrams utilized that and everything, bond.
It was good. I especially liked the I guess you could say, the foreshadowing sequence, mm-hmm. you know, the visions that she saw.
Yeah.
Especially once she had got a hold of the lightsaber,
yeah.
which was another scene that the second that it had become an iconic, you know, piece of weaponry in the original trilogy. So when people finally saw it again, they lost their minds.
Oh yeah.
You know, another one of those.
And it's another, there's another mystery. It opens up another mystery. It's like,
did she get it?
Yeah, because it was on Bespin when you lost it.
Yeah. I don't know. With glasses like that, she might have been maintenance. You know, she might have just been, you know, cleaning something out and all of a sudden it just...
Well, at her old job and everything, we've had a lot of maintenance ladies with those glasses.
Yeah.
But you know, when she flashed back, she saw Luke, you know, embracing R2 and everything, like he's exhausted from battle and everything. And then Kylo Ren looks like he's attacking people and everything. And
it even had some of her own personal history.
Yeah. Now to get and it showed her as a little child being left on the planet Jakku.
Yeah.
But what was even more is now we're going to get into Kylo Ren. They mentioned it right off. They never hinted towards the end. They mentioned it right off the bat when they were talking to Kylo Ren was talking to the hologram version of Supreme Leader Snoke.
Yeah.
Who nobody still knows who he is and everything. And there's still speculations, but we're going to ignore those right now. But you know, he looks right down and everything, and they're talking about.
Yeah.
And he basically says, "Your father, Han Solo."
Yeah.
Said it right there and then. There was no big surprise towards the end, like...
Well, I mean, I think it was one of those cases where everybody had speculated.
Yeah.
You know, it was one of those cases where in the movie, speculation had been so great in that direction.
Yeah.
You knew it was going to happen anyway.
Yeah.
I mean, there's just no way it could have unfolded any other way.
And he ended up becoming the character. He's Ben Solo.
Yeah.
It's Kylo Ren's real name. But then all of a sudden, you know, you get back, and then they find out where BB-8 and Han Solo and them all live at. It was on this planet, and they all start attacking it and everything. And I have to say, this battle, even though it was rather short and everything, I'm going to say this right now. Harrison Ford held this film together.
Oh, yeah.
This is some of the... I mean, and this is him playing a character he's played 3 times before.
Yeah.
And he really just held this movie together. I mean, he had a great supporting cast with him.
Yeah.
Everybody else held their own, but just, I guess because, you know, seeing him back.
It was a familiarity.
Yeah.
You know?
I mean, he didn't have that when he came to the last Indiana Jones film.
Well, you know,
I think it was because of this cast
that
surrounded him, enriched his character in this film.
He took on that basic mentor role, in a way, which, you know, it was just, it was good to see him back. I mean, I think the familiarity with Han Solo really helped.
Mm-hmm.
I think the fact that he took on more of a mentor role when it came to dealing with Rey and Finn to an extent, you know, I think seeing him in that capacity was what helped put the movie together.
And, you know, to hear him, you know, talk about, like, in the trailer and everything, you know, it was all true. The dark side, the Jedi. Yeah. Hearing him, you know, because when you first saw him, you know, he's like, I don't believe in that.
Yeah.
That's hokey pokey religion, you know.
Yeah.
And just to seeing how... Everybody just developed and everything, and you know, at the everybody fighting. Daisy Ridley is run away because she does not want to accept the fact that she's a Jedi and that she's never going to see the people she's been waiting for because she's waiting for her family to come back to get her. But she runs away, and John Boyega is trying to run away, but then he realized that he's trying to say he decides we got to save her and everything.
Yeah,
and she has this really cool battle with Kylo Ren in a way with a laser blaster, you know, trying to shoot at him and everything, and then he just holds it with the force.
Yeah, it was, it's a lot like his battle on Jakku, you know, which we had talked about Vader actually deflecting blaster bolts. You come to see that he can actually stop
him. Stop him, completely. Yeah.
which you know, seeing him do that battle with Daisy Ridley was interesting.
Yeah,
you got to see how powerful a Force user could be.
Exactly.
You know, without just the cliche would have been Force choke.
Yeah.
You know, just the whole holding.
And then his interrogation ways of using that too.
Yeah.
But I have to say though, when you know, seeing Han and Chewie battle and everything, just shooting people left and right and everything. Yeah. And then Han just casually, just not even looking, shoots a stormtrooper off in the background and everything.
You gotta wonder, there, scoundrel luck or, you know, battle reflexes?
Yeah.
Just, you know, is it a classic Han Solo luck scenario, or is it just, yeah, I know there's a guy usually over here.
Yeah. And then, you know, seeing John Boyega use the lightsaber, you know. I'm not a trained Jedi, but it also shows that one stormtrooper and everything that had those, that type of... you know, rod stick. I forgot what they called them.
I don't know what they actually called it, but you know, in the older
expanded universe,
they had something called the vibro blade that could stand up to a lightsaber. This looked like some sort of energy baton.
Yeah.
Which almost looked like a policeman's nightstick in the way that he used it.
The way he turned it around and everything to lock it in.
And it was interesting to see, but it was at that point you could really kind of see that. Most people speculated anybody with a lightsaber could take on anybody.
Yeah.
You really got to see that the training of the Jedi was what made them so lethal with those lightsabers.
Yeah.
Because while John Boyega did good, he wasn't no Jedi by any definition of it.
Yeah. But I have to also, you know, when all of a sudden they were being held prisoner, and then they realized, you know, they see this what looked like a wave coming towards the structure that they were at and everything, then all of a sudden Han Solo's like, it's the Resistance, and you see these X-Wings, you know, gliding over, you know, this river and everything, and, you know, Poe Dameron has somehow managed to get back to the Resistance, and he's, you know, shooting at, and then had this big aerial dogfight, you know.
Yeah.
And it was almost like the type of aerial dogfights that George Lucas was trying to accomplish in the original film when it comes to the Death Star battle scenes. And
well, it's a clear-cut case of, you know, having the funds and the ability to do so. I mean, the original trilogy was...
It's a low-budget film.
Very low-budget. I mean, it just did not have the resources that Disney does.
Yeah.
You know, that's part of what made that such a possibility, and probably what's just a really good scene.
Yeah.
It's just a really visually enticing scene.
Yeah. And I, again, just... absolutely was just blown away by the aerial dogfights and everything.
Yeah.
And then all of a sudden Han Solo notices Kylo Ren, and he, you know, he knows who it is.
Yeah.
And, you know, he carries off Rey's character. And then I had to say when this ship lands right in front of him and everything, Han Solo knows, I know who's in that ship.
Yeah.
And it ends up, you know, emerging from the ship is now General Leia, and, you know,
we all have that instinct when our ex is around.
Yeah.
You know, that, oh God, she's near.
Yeah.
Something bad's going to happen.
Mm-hmm. I felt that.
Yeah.
But but I love the fact that C-3PO, again, gets in between them.
Yeah.
You know, hi, I'm C-3PO. Do you recognize, you know, it's like basically, you know, trying to jog his memory. You may not recognize me with the red arm. Which, you know,
I admit the red arm was kind of cool.
Yeah.
You know, you're used to seeing gold C-3PO. I just, my imagination just went off. I saw that red arm. I'm like, how the hell did he lose it this time?
Yeah.
Did he get blown to pieces again? What the hell happened to that arm?
Again, that's probably something you'll find out in the future films.
Well, he said he was going to get it reinstalled, so I'm assuming he has it somewhere. I don't want to know what's been used for, but,
But we, of course, you know, they get this little bantering and everything.
Yeah.
And just, of course, you know, while they're bantering, you know, they're talking about the Death Star and, you know.
Well, I believe it was exactly, you know, you don't really do anything and don't mention the Death Star.
Yeah.
Yeah, which you could kind of see Han Solo at that point, like, this argument again. Help her with the Death Star and she's never appreciative.
Yeah. But it just showing, you know, how she is evolved into this now military leader. You would think maybe she'd be this elegant senator or, you know, head of the Republic and everything, but no, she's still fighting the good fight. You know, she's still out there in the front lines, you know, pushing the troops to make sure that the justice is going to be served, and that, you know, the trinity of evil forces and everything will be stopped. And that's her way of treating it and everything. She decided not to become a Jedi.
Yeah.
And that, you know, she and Han and everything talked about how, you know, their son, you know, is lost and everything. Yeah. You know, it's like they're talking about how their son, it's like their son's dead.
Well, Han more talks about him like he's dead.
Yeah.
You know, he talks like he believes that Kylo Ren is Kylo Ren.
Yeah.
That's who he is. You know, their son is gone.
Yeah.
But Leia, you know, as the mother, as, you know, in general, usually is the softer of the two, is just more on, you know, no, he's lost.
Yeah.
We can bring him back, you know. Which, you know...
And as a Jedi, she senses the light side still in him.
Yeah. Well, you see the one part where, you know, he admits he's having some trouble with, you know...
When he talks to Vader's helmet.
Yeah.
Which, you know, at that time I didn't get a chance to see that scene because, you know, my son had to...
I saw that scene. That was awesome.
Because my son had to go to the bathroom 40 times. But I love you, Phoenix. But yeah, I have to say that...
You know what? That speaks to your love. You were willing to miss pieces of the Star Wars movie for that.
Yeah, next time I'm bringing a bottle with me.
That would be long words. Hey, buddy, I don't care what row you're in. You lock it up.
Is that kid peeing in a bottle? Hey, I've been waiting 3 years for this movie.
What? He had the large soda. Don't go there with me, all right?
But, I have to say that, you know, just having them show also the, now to get into the plans that they were starting.
Yeah.
When it came to the Starkiller base. And they're like, what, this is another Death Star? And they're like, this is not just another Death Star. And they show the comparison. Here's the Death Star. They literally did. Here's the Death Star, and here's Starkiller base. And, you know, basically the Death Star is the size
of
a moon.
Golf ball basketball.
Yeah. I mean, that's pretty much what you can say.
It was interesting to... I love the fact that they gave you a frame of reference.
Yeah.
You know, because, I mean, you see in the original trilogy the size of the Death Star. They thought it was a moon. I mean, obviously big.
Yeah.
But when they give you that frame of reference that, you know, here's the Death Star, you know, and then here's Starkiller Base, that really just ups the wow factor.
And then you had somebody, another little interaction inside the theater and everything, somebody going,
There was so many people in that, just, they were like, damn, you know? I know one guy, he had to be at least two rows back, just went, damn, look at that! I was just sitting there thinking, this guy here, I'm going to bring him along whenever I want to order a large. You know? I don't want large. I want, what kind of large am I looking for? Damn! I'm looking for that large. You got that large in stock? I want that large. It was just a really great thing to see. I mean, the fact that it's actually powered by a sun.
Yeah. You know, it sucks the sun.
Yeah.
Of all of its power and everything until it's nothing.
Which, you gotta wonder what the reload factor on that is. You know, do you have to relocate it every time you use up the sun?
You must barely have to.
I wonder how the hell they're gonna move that thing, you know? I mean, think about it. Is it gonna be towed? Did they think about it before, you know?
I'm pretty sure that they had some type of thruster like they did. Well, it's like the Death Star. Death Star moved.
True.
So, but again, you know, this is basically, you know, it lived up to its name, Starkiller. Yeah. And that, of course, was the original treatment name to Luke Skywalker's character. You know, it was Luke Starkiller. So that was an homage to, you know, George Lucas's original outline to the Star Wars saga.
Yeah, but also, if you think about it, the apprentice for Force Unleashed, his name was Starkiller.
Yeah, that's right. So, I mean...
I think it was a good way of paying homage to all the work that had come before.
Yeah. I mean, I think that... And just the fact that they used the name Ben Solo. Ben was, of course...
Yeah.
You know, Ben Skywalker in the expanded universe. And, you know, they were borrowing pieces from the expanded universe. You know, they weren't going to say... We're going to completely ignore all that. You know, which, in a way, they did with the story arcs. But, you know, it was still nice to, you know, them paying homage to those people who worked hard.
Yeah.
To keep Star Wars alive for the last 20 years, in between films. I have to say, though, what really stuck out and everything with Daisy Ridley was how she started understanding, okay, I can use the Force.
Yeah.
And her interrogation against Kylo Ren.
Yeah.
Proving that Kylo Ren is not all powerful.
Yeah.
That he is being used as a tool.
Yeah.
And
it was very interesting to see the way it was done, too. I mean, just her all of a sudden realizing she's Force sensitive, and then within minutes being able to use the Force.
Mm-hmm. And also that, yeah. You know, how when Kylo Ren removes his helmet and everything.
Yeah.
And then he realizes, you know, when he's trying to use the Force on her and everything to interrogate her.
Yeah.
He realizes she's like me. And you can also sense, you kind of can sense a little bit that he seems to be falling for her.
Yeah, I think it was the fact that, you know, kind of a longing for a similar entity.
Yeah.
You know, he didn't have anybody but stormtroopers to really deal with.
Yeah.
You know, they talk about Force-sensitive people being more sensitive, you know, to others as well as, you know, just what's around them. So I think it was just kind of a mirroring almost.
Yeah.
Just understanding that there might be somebody he can actually, you know, relate to. Yeah.
But the ways that, you know, she fought.
Yeah.
Fought with him and everything. And it was just, and I'd have to say this. Adam Driver played this part so well. And also the way he would pitch what I call Anakin fits.
Yeah.
Young Anakin fits and everything. The way he'd tear up this machine, tear up the controls in front of him and everything. And how some of the people are so afraid of him. I like the one scene where the stormtroopers are walking down the hallway. And they see sparks coming out and everything. And stuff. They just stop, look at each other, and turn right around. I mean, and this film had the humor.
I think you hit the nail on the head with the whole Anakin Fitz thing. I think you could really see his admiration for Darth Vader.
Yeah.
I mean, just the fact, longer hair, kind of like Hayden Christensen in the prequels.
Mm-hmm.
The fact that he uses Force choke on that officer.
Yeah.
You know, I mean, just, it was really, you could really tell what kind of character he was and what kind of character he was going to be.
Yeah.
You almost saw, even though he was this big imposing character, you almost saw a childish nature to him in a way.
Like a spoiled brat.
Yeah, yeah, and very much so.
And I have to say, you know, it just, when I was saying about the humor and everything, the humor hit the point, you know. Especially when they went to Han and Finn agreed to go rescue Rey and then you infiltrate the Starkiller and everything. When they're running around with like chickens with their head cut off and everything, and they're like trying to figure out what's going on, and Solo's doing this, and he's like, what are you nodding your head for? What are you, come to find out, Rey has gotten herself loose and everything, she by using the Jedi mind track, and at first, you know, it didn't work and everything, he's like, the stormtrooper's like, I'm going to tighten those things, and make sure that you stay in here, and lock the door, and then she finally uses the Force, gets using more strength and everything, and she's like, you're going to unlock these bolts. You're going to let me go. You're going to open the door, walk away.
You could hear almost a confidence in her voice.
Yeah.
Just kind of a calm, you know, just kind of flat confidence.
Yeah, and then when she says, then you're going to drop the gun. I'm going to drop the gun.
Yeah.
And just
that
walk.
Part you could kind of hear like a, I can't believe that just worked.
Yeah.
Let me push the envelope. You're going to leave your gun. I'm going to leave my gun.
But, and then, okay, jump around. They Han and Chewie starts laying bombs around. And then to get to the point, what a lot of people now know, is that, you know, Han sees, Kylo Ren senses his father there, and he starts walking around a place, and there's this walkway, large walkway. Yeah. Han Solo's just laid some, you know, some explosives around, and then he sees Kylo Ren, his son Ben, and he's, you know, because earlier him and Leia talked about, you know, we gotta reach him. You know, we gotta talk to him, you're his father, you know, try to talk to him. And then he walks up to the beginning of the platform and everything, yells out his name, Ben.
Yeah.
And then he turns around, you know, Kylo turns around, he's like, you can take the helmet off, you don't need it. You know, he takes it off and they start talking and Kylo Ren is, you know, discussing with him what, you know, I'm having these feelings, I need you to help me.
Yeah.
I need you to help me with this.
You know, that was a scene that, verbally, you cannot put it into the visual way it was done.
Yeah.
You just really can't. I mean, with all that was going on outside with the dogfight and the battle, at the same time, it's draining the sun so it can, you know, gather all the energy to fire that beam. You know, you can see it physically getting darker outside while this conversation is going on between the two of them. I mean, there was just so many visual cues that...
Like showing that the light side is
completely
leaving him.
You could really see it extinguishing.
Yeah.
I mean, it was just masterfully done. The fact that you see Kylo Ren handing his lightsaber to his father's holding onto it with both hands, you know. It was just the way it was done. It slowly, gradually built you into what you knew was going to be the inevitable conclusion.
Yeah, and then, you know, finally everybody, since since they found out Harrison Ford was going to be in it, Han Solo's dead.
Yeah.
You know, Kylo Ren takes his lightsaber and impales him.
Yeah.
The embracing of his face, you know, showing that, you know, I still love you.
Well,
type of
it's
moment.
It's that father's love. Yeah. You know, it doesn't matter how bad your kid hurts you, you love your kid.
Yeah.
I mean, it's just the way it is.
And then seeing him, you know, basically fall back and then falling over.
Yeah.
You know, and you just see Han Solo descend down to this large, almost endless abyss.
Yeah.
Okay, now we get into before the death of Solo and everything, you know, they show the destruction of Coruscant, which to me was the biggest shocker.
It was kind of like shedding the old storyline in a bit. I mean, it was always between the Republic and the Empire.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and then all of a sudden, the Republic's gone.
Yeah.
The Empire had fallen in Return of the Jedi, now the Republic's gone.
Yeah.
I think it made way perfectly for the First Order and the Resistance.
I
think it was just something they had to do in order to completely move on with the story.
Exactly. I mean, as I said, it was a big... It's almost kind of like the destruction of Vulcan in Star Trek.
There you go.
J.J. likes the destruction of planets. I don't know what the deal is with this guy, but...
He's Galactus.
Yeah.
Dear God. Well, we see some guy in silver, we'll know.
Yeah. In purple spandex.
That'll be terrible. There are very few people in the world that should wear spandex.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But, and then also now that Kylo Ren has killed back to the death of Han Solo.
Yeah.
We see him falling in. And Chewbacca gets a really good hit on Kylo Ren. You know, he starts roaring and everything, and he pops one off, and it hits Kylo Ren.
Center mass. Yeah, right here in the stomach there.
Yeah.
You know, it was a good shot, especially from that distance.
Yeah.
And then it hits off a Wookiee.
And then you see Chewbacca running and, you know, hitting stormtroopers and... Ridley and John Boyega's characters both see, you know, what just happened and everything. And
their reaction was very reminiscent of Luke losing Obi-Wan in A New Hope. It's another case where they followed that formula, but it really worked out.
So, but it was, you know, as I said, it took the breath out of you. It took the fun out of the movie. The movie stopped being fun, it's become
a
drama.
It hit that darker note. Yeah. It hit that darker note to it is what it did.
Yeah, and... I mean, as that people were just dead silent.
Oh, no.
I think they were dead silent almost through most of the movie.
I believe I heard at least 6 people react to that, besides any gasping or you know, just one of those, oh, my God. No, there was a guy in the back, damn, you know. And another guy went, holy hell. And I heard somebody certain expletives, you know. But, yeah, it was a hard moment for a lot of diehard Star Wars fans.
Yeah.
I mean, though, like I said, it built up to it. You kind of felt it was going to happen. You still held out that little bit of hope.
Yeah.
You know?
But also, and then you mentioned when it came to Finn using the lightsaber and everything.
Yeah.
He held his own against it. It just shows you that Kylo Ren is not this powerful dark warrior and everything. He's not a Sith Lord at all.
It was... They humanized him.
Yeah.
You know, it was something they held off to with Vader, but I like that they started early with this.
Yeah.
You know, that they show that he is fallible.
Yeah. And then as Han said to him and everything, Snoke is only using you.
Yeah.
And once you're done, he's done with you, you're just like a disposable. Yeah.
Which I think this might open the door to more Sith characters.
Yeah.
You know, I mean, it's always been, you know, master and apprentice.
Yeah.
You know? Maybe the fact that he's hinting at, you know, at Kylo Ren just being a tool, maybe it opens the door to more Sith characters.
Maybe. I mean, honestly, I mean, as I said, he's a Knight of Ren.
Yeah.
And you'll probably find out more about those because, you know, when everybody was outside and everything, you know, Kylo Ren follows them out there.
Yeah.
And John Boyega's character, Finn, and everything, he's fighting his, you know, with the lightsaber the best he can and everything. Rey's been knocked out and everything, and Next, you know, they are fighting, and Kylo Ren is, you know, you find out, you know, the purpose of those.
They have a purpose. Yeah. You know, so many people talk crap about them, but they had a purpose. During the classic lightsaber lock, you know, he actually turns that handle and gets that prong right into the shoulder of Finn. You
know, and then he strikes Finn.
So many people talk crap about that. I was so glad they incorporated that.
And then they strike. He strikes Finn in the back. Finn falls unconscious and everything with no movement. You think he's dead. And then Rey realizes, you know, Kylo sees the Darth Vader's lightsaber.
Yeah.
And the first thing he does, you know, when Finn turns that lightsaber on, he's like, that belongs to me.
Yeah.
You know, because he knew that that was his father and he knew, or his grandfather's lightsaber.
Yeah.
And then all of a sudden, you know, Adam Driver's, as Kylo Ren's trying to reach for it using the Force, and then all of a sudden, it just completely shoots right past him. And he looks over and Rey's got it.
Yeah.
And she turns it on, and then the best lightsaber duel since, you know, you'd have to say Obi-Wan and Anakin was a pretty good lightsaber duel, and then, you know.
It definitely held in the top three for me. You know, I mean, in fact, I would say out of the top three of mine were, you know, the classic Yoda, Dooku, Anakin, and Obi-Wan, you know, and then when the Phantom Menace, it used to be Qui-Gon, Darth Maul, and Obi-Wan.
Yeah.
But I'll have to say, that just totally debunked that one.
And she whipped his ass.
She did, yeah.
It just proves, one, you know, a Jedi that's, you know...
Well, you know, it...
Force, they use the Force.
I think it also bridged the gap,
is
what it did. The fact that Kylo Ren was injured,
mm-hmm.
you know, you could see an evening on the playing field.
Yeah.
Her rage coupled with his injury. At the same time, you kind of saw one of the staples of the Sith Lords. You know, he's trying to use pain in order to bolster his power.
Yeah.
He keeps hitting himself right in the wound.
Yeah.
You know, which, it was just an amazing duel.
And it shows that Kylo Ren is not this powerful being. Again, it just shows him that he's just a tool. He's been fed so much BS that he believes in himself as being this powerful being that uses the Force and everything. And he's not a Sith Lord.
Yeah.
He's not a Jedi. He's just this guy who has these abilities and he uses them for the wrong reasons. And I mean, if he was a true Sith Lord, he'd be shooting Force lightning now.
Yeah.
So I think, you know, honestly, I don't think that Supreme Leader Snoke is a Sith Lord in any way. I don't think he's Darth Plagueis. A lot of people think he is.
I don't know about him being Darth Plagueis, but I don't quite know where he fits in. There's a lot of speculation on it. But you can obviously see in some way, shape, or form he knows about the Force.
Yeah. And then the detonation of the explosives go off. And then that leads up for Poe and everything, and his squadron and everything, to start attacking and everything. The planet... from within, they kind of do a whole thing with
it's very reminiscent
Return of the Jedi
the Death Star,
and then they go off and everything and get everything, a chain reaction of the planet start to destroy itself, and it shows the people of the First Order that they're not these ruthless people, they're cowards, and they're scared, you know, they're like, you know, the general's like, stand your ground, Lieutenant, he's like, forget you, and he basically runs off. And then he runs up to, you know, General Hawk. He was more of a Nazi type of officer.
Yeah.
He nailed that whole Nazi type of attitude that you would see during those old World War II movies and everything to a T. I mean, he was dressed apart. He looked apart. He had the attitude of the Aryan type of attitude that a Nazi officer would have.
He was just... very self-important, very sure of himself.
And you can tell the conflicts between him and Kylo Ren.
Yeah.
The general runs to the hologram room where they speak to Supreme Leader Snoke, and he's like, gather Kylo Ren and bring him back home to complete his training. So you know that Kylo Ren, you know, is just incomplete.
Which, you know, I found odd because he said he was the strongest of the Knights of Ren.
Yeah.
So, I mean, if his training's not complete,
how
much stronger could he get?
Exactly. So it makes you wonder how the second act of the story is going to play out.
Like I said, I think it might possibly introduce a few more Sith characters. Mm.
I think, honestly, too, though, is that I don't think Kylo Ren can be ever redeemed after the killing of Han Solo and everything.
In fact, I made a made a comment to Zach, who I went with. I said, you know, I wouldn't be surprised to see Leia die in the next one.
Yeah, I wouldn't be surprised either.
I told him it would have, for me, it probably would have ended out a little differently if Leia tried to talk to Ren instead of Han Solo.
Yeah.
I think the ending, end result would have been the same, but I think the story arc would have just been just slightly different.
Yeah.
You know?
But once we get there and everything, you know, get to the point where the planet's blowing up.
Yeah.
The Millennium Falcon, you know, they Chewbacca and them, you know, gets onto the Millennium Falcon, and you know, Rey, you know, right as soon as Rey's about to, you know, and Kylo Ren are about to fight and everything, the planet starts
just as she's about to strike him down.
Yeah, the planet starts breaking apart and everything. They look at each other, and next, you know, she runs to Finn, who's still unconscious, and she's in, you know, suddenly the these lights hit her and everything, and it's Chewbacca and the Millennium Falcon. They all get aboard and they fly back. After the planet Starkiller base, you know, crumbles and destroys itself, everybody comes home and celebrates, you know. They bring Finn onto this medical transport and everything, find out there's a heartbeat.
Yep.
And then, you know, Leia is there to, walks up to Rey and comforts her.
It was a interesting scene. I mean, like I said earlier, it seemed like the characters that we knew in the trilogy, the heroes, became more figures of, like, myth.
Yeah.
And you see everybody else kind of just run off into a group and they're celebrating, but you see Leia Organa, you know, walk over to Rey and actually embrace her in a hug because they both feel the loss of Han Solo.
Yeah.
You know, it was a interesting moment.
Yeah, I said, you know, that right there, I mean, as much as I hated it, I understand story as a writer, I'd understand that death of a character. You know, that important character, like Han Solo had been. You know, he's always been a supporting character. But this time around, they knew they were going to let him go.
Yeah.
And this gave him his moment to shine. And he was kind of like, you know, how Liam Neeson held episode one together.
Yeah.
And you're like, oh, man, they killed him off and everything. And that you felt that loss. Because you
they built a cast around a strong actor.
Yeah, exactly.
And that's exactly what Harrison Ford was. He was a very strong actor. If anything, just knowing he was in it would help draw people.
Exactly.
You know? Yeah. He was the veteran. As much as he was the mentor in the film, he was the mentor on the set.
Yeah. And it's sad that, it's sad to see him go, but who knows?
Yeah.
Force Ghost Hall.
That would be cool.
I mean, I just can't see him completely going away. I mean, somewhere along the lines, I see.
I figure maybe ghost, flashbacks,
maybe, or something. Yeah,
Force Ghost, something like that.
Or something like that. Or if Kylo Ren's about to go down, there's going to be some type of redemption of some way, somehow. I figure they'll figure something out. If not, then you know it's something you're going to have to live with.
Yeah. Bitter pill to swallow, but you know.
I mean, personally, I think it's going to hurt Indiana Jones 5.
There's a good chance of that.
Yeah. So I mean, it's going to a lot of fans are pissed. I mean, my middle boy, Phoenix, he was like, that's it, I'm done. They killed Han Solo real loud in the theater, too.
There you go.
And, I mean, I felt, you know, you felt
You got a future heavy critic there.
Yeah.
I realized that.
but there was a lot of things that, after that, you know, Rey's, like, talking to Finn while he was on the bed.
Yeah.
And, you know, she tells him that, I will see you again, my friend. She gives him a kiss on the forehead.
Yeah.
And their chemistry worked real well together. You didn't know if they were going to get together as a couple or not.
It was almost a sibling-like,
you
know, back and forth. And at the same time, you saw moments of possible romantic entanglement.
Yeah, well, it's just like this is the first person that Finn's actually been able to care about.
Yeah.
You know, he made a quick bond to her. And she, too, and everything. She had nobody ever in her life, and he didn't either, and everything. That's how they bonded.
Yeah.
But I'd have to say, though, when... she walked away, you know, then you're like, okay, she's going on a journey. And she's kind of like in an outfit similar to what she's been wearing, but it's more of a resistant style.
It's almost like a gray robe kind of deal. You know, it's pretty cool.
But she and Chewbacca, along with C-3PO and R2-D2, are going to go on this journey to look for Luke, because they finally, when they got the map and everything, R2-D2 wakes up. He had been dormant for many years while Luke was gone, which was probably part of the plan. And then the piece of the puzzle was that R2-D2 had the rest of
the map.
Of the map, so everything was connected. So now they knew where Luke was at. And so Rey, Chewbacca, C-3PO, and R2-D2 going part of the Millennium Falcon. Leia says, Rey, may the Force be with you.
Yeah.
And then they launch off and they go off and find this planet. Rey starts climbing, you know, while everybody's on this platform, that on this island, you know, Chewie, 3PO, and R2, they sit and wait. Rey starts going on this long journey around these mountains. And then she climbs this mountain, and this mountain edge, you know, she finally stops and looks. She notices that there's somebody in front of her. And then you see the back figure of a person wearing this Jedi robe, and he turns around, and it's Luke. He doesn't say anything. Nothing said at all.
Yeah.
And all she has to do is, in her knapsack, she pulls out his lightsaber, and she's holding it out to him like, you're needed.
Yeah.
We need you. Without saying a word. And then Luke just kind of has this look of worriment and upset, because, you know, obviously he probably feels the death of Han Solo.
Yeah.
But, again, you know...
See, now, I had wondered, there was a small rock, if you look at mm-hmm. it, that almost looked like a headstone.
Yeah.
So I had wondered, maybe, you know, if it was a headstone. Maybe yeah. he felt Han's death and actually made a little something.
There. Yeah.
You know, just right off at the bottom of his feet, if you see the movie and you look down, there's just that small little rock there.
Yeah.
I wondered what that was. It just seemed out of place.
I mean, it's up for interpretation, and I think that's one of the great reasons about not telling every detail.
Yeah.
It gives everybody this chance to really, you know, I mean,
it was like I said, it's one of those movies that it's, visually, there's just so much to see.
Yeah.
A picture is truly worth a thousand words.
Exactly.
We could sit here and talk this down all day
and analyze
still
it.
Still not give you an eighth of how good this movie is.
Yeah. As I said, this is not Empire good. This is Star Wars good.
Yeah.
And I'm just glad it's not Episode 2 bad. But I have to say, it literally leaves off at a cliffhanger.
It's the definition of a cliffhanger.
Yeah.
They're on the edge of a cliff.
Exactly.
You know,
and I keep telling people, I'm like, okay, well, I'll tell you one thing about the end. It literally leaves on a cliffhanger. But it was weird to see, you know, when it said direct the ending scrolls and everything, it said directed by J.J. Abrams. And again, you know, it's like this has been handed off to a new generation. When Lucas decided to sell back in 2012,
is that a good bottle?
And he, you know, you got the worries and the feel that, you know, okay, he's not going to make any more himself.
Yeah.
But it also, it leaves that worry, like, okay, who's going to be making these? And then when J.J. Abrams came aboard and you heard that he was handpicked by Lucas himself, that you felt some easement.
Some, but not a lot.
Yeah.
I mean, it's still...
I was just happy not to see all these lens flares like you see in Star Trek movies now.
Yeah.
But I was happy with this film. I was not disappointed. I knew everything was going on. The only thing that shocked me was the destruction of Coruscant.
And the Senate.
Yeah. And that's the one thing that did shock me. But yet again, I was really happy with this movie.
Oh, yeah.
It felt like Star Wars. And I said, you know, there's only one Star Wars film I really don't like the much, and that was Episode 2. But this...
They concentrated on all the wrong places.
Yeah. But this one really just felt it, and the cast was wonderful.
Oh, yeah.
And Harrison Ford, again, we talked about Rocky off camera one time.
Yeah.
The new Creed movie.
Creed movie.
Which we'll touch on a little bit. Thank you. Went on to say that, you know, we feel like Sylvester Stallone could get an Oscar nomination.
Yeah.
A lot of people feel that. I think Harrison Ford should at least try to get that.
Oh, yeah.
I think they should consider him for an Oscar nomination because he held this movie together.
He did.
And he came in, what, 20 minutes into the film? About that.
About 20, 30 minutes.
Somewhere. Yeah. And he just gave us that presence. It's like he wasn't...
Hey.
Like all the other performances before just were flat the last few years of what he has done.
A little bit, you know. I think it was just how he fit that character like a glove. In a way, it was like him going home.
Yeah, literally.
You know, just his
going full circle with his career.
Yeah, it was one of those things. I think he was comfortable.
Mm-hmm.
I think the fact that he was looked up to so much, the fact that the fans were so hyped to see him,
mm-hmm.
I think it all just meshed very well into just this great movie that it is.
I just hope,
this
you know,
great character.
As much as I hated the death of Han Solo, I just hope it doesn't, you know, tarnish this film.
I mean, I don't know. I mean, there was a lot of speculation that this film would not be as good as the previous six. I mean, any of the previous six. I mean, there's been people speculating that, you know, they prefer older films. You know, I don't think it'll be tarnished by the death of Han Solo. I think it'll really just give the cast
set its precedence
to grow.
Yeah.
You know, I think it'll just give them room to grow.
But I do feel that, as I said, I don't expect this to be the greatest Star Wars film ever made. I never expected it to be that way.
Yeah.
But I do sense that this was as good as it can make it. And it was a good film. I mean, this movie already, on opening day, Thursday and everything,
broke the box office at $57 million.
Yeah, $57 million.
$57 million.
And then its advanced ticket sales were...
Advanced ticket sales were up into, I think, 200? $100 million or something like that.
Plus, I mean, it broke records all the way around. And right now...
It broke the internet.
Yeah. It literally broke the internet when you watch that trailer reaction.
Yeah.
But again, this movie was great. I loved it. I can have nothing.
Oh yeah.
Anything against it? I give it a full 5 stars.
Oh hell yeah.
And I want to say this one last thing. I enjoy everybody watching our shows, doing this countdown of The Force Awakens. My kids will do their review. And I just also want to thank Paul for everything that he has done, contribute to the making of these videos.
Oh no.
Next week we're going to have end of the year review of everything that's gone on, and we're going to do a little award ceremony at the end. I just want to thank everybody. Okay, once again, I want to thank everybody for joining us, and I had a blast. This has been a great year.
Oh yeah.
Been a rough year, but it's been a great year. We'll definitely see you guys next week on our end of the year review show. Once again, I'm William Baxter.
And I'm Paul Bell.
This is Ocean, and we want to say may the Force be with you always.
She's gonna try to cut me down again.
She's a mean little thing.
Yeah.
You do that?
I still got it in the beard.
All right, folks. See you later. Star Wars easy. Force Awakens out there. Watch it over and over again. And we'll make sure that these kids will be doing their own review. So we'll see you later.
Take it easy.